Riverton City Council to order at 7 p.m. Would Councilmember Peterson lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, and Councilmember Larson will offer the invocation.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our Father in heaven, we are thankful for the opportunity to be here at City Council and to serve the citizens of Riverton. Father, we are thankful for all the blessings that we have for this free country. Thankful for the opportunity to live here. Ask that thou might bless and watch over us, that we might say and do those things which are pleasing unto thee and to thy citizens. Father, we are thankful for all the blessings that we have, this free country, and we say this humbly. Name thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Would the city clerk please conduct a roll call?
Yes, Your Honor. Councilman Tim Hancock.
Here.
Councilman Mike Bailey.
Here.
Councilman Kyle Larson.
Present.
Councilman Sean Peterson.
Here.
Councilwoman Holly Gibbon.
Here.
Mayor John Baker.
I am present. The chair would entertain a motion to excuse Lee Martinez tonight.
Motion to excuse Lee Martinez tonight.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mayor votes aye and the motion passes. I declare that we have a quorum. Chair would entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
Motion to approve the agenda is written.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion or amendments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mayor votes aye and it passes. The first thing is the consideration of air service contract. Public Works Director's report, please.
Thank you, Your Honor. Coming before you is consideration of an amendment to the existing contract the City of Riverton holds with Denver Air Connection. As you are aware, that contract runs from July 1st of 2017. 2016, excuse me, to June 30th of 2017. I will not repeat everything that has been included and given to you in your staff report, but I do want to highlight that, again, as the Riverton Regional Airport is owned and operated by the City of Riverton, the City Council is the legal body for anything that occurs at that airport. Therefore, it is the authority for signing contracts related to air service. To assist the council in procuring air service, improving air service, a task force was created in 2013. That task force is the Fremont Air Service Team, and we do have many members here today that are of that task force. For the benefit of the viewing public, the objective of FAST, which is that task force, is to represent regional air service interests for our community and to seek out potential air service providers, negotiate contracts, manage potential revenue guarantees, and ensure stable and fair ticket pricing for travelers. So with that, I would like to introduce FAST and have them present to you information about this consideration of year number two of Denver Air Connection service. So I'll turn the time to our representatives with FAST.
Mr. Mayor and the Council, thank you for having us here, and what a difference a year makes. A year ago when we came before you, we weren't sure if we were going to have air service in Fremont County, and it's quite delightful to now be here in front of you to say that we've had a really successful year.
Excuse me, does everybody know Missy White? Okay, all right.
Great, thank you. All right, so we want to do a quick presentation. I realize most of you are fairly familiar with this. Some folks are a little bit newer to it. So we want to be able to make sure we're all on the same page about what we're talking about. So briefly about where we came from, things started spiraling downward, reminding folks that Great Lakes came before the council in May of 2013 because air service had been so bad through the winter and into the spring, and assuring us that things would get better. Unfortunately, it didn't, and things continued to decline in reliability and cancellations and whatnot, although the flying public remained the same. We've been pretty steady at 26,000 enplanements from Fremont County residents throughout the years, but fewer and fewer coming to the Riverton Regional Airport for that. So by 2015, it had dropped to below 4,000 passengers for the year. So the challenge of not having that reliable service led to extraordinarily high percentage of leakage, at times as much as 80%. Heading to other airports. And happily, we are reversing that trend. So Denver Air Connection began servicing the Riverton Airport in July 1st, sharing the service with Sheridan. These numbers are actually both passengers coming and going. So it looks a little larger than some of the other reports you've seen, but we went from very few passengers to doubling in fairly short time. One of the things that we were excited about that this bar graph shows, but only if you know the behind the scenes, is that nationwide, industry-wide, air travel tends to tank in January. Everyone's got the holiday travel hangover. They've traveled for Thanksgiving, they traveled for Christmas, they don't travel in January. We didn't see that in Riverton. Folks are coming back and traveling out of Riverton, and we're really pleased with that. Likewise, we're slowly but steady watching our booked revenue improve over time, month by month, generally getting better. Again, industry-wide tends to see a big dip in January. We saw very little and actually stayed well above the previous month. So we've got a steady improvement exactly the way we want to be seeing things. So things that have changed since then, a big one that we hear about all the time is that the reliability of Denver Air Connection is impeccable. We were trying to figure out if there have been any cancellations other than due to weather-related, and we can't think of any and haven't seen any in the history. And even for the weather-related, that's on Denver's end, not on our end, and that's pretty remarkable. Likewise, I've had folks stop me in the grocery store and say, wow, I'd forgotten that staff can be friendly and helpful. I love the Denver Air Connection staff. They're super helpful, they're friendly, they go out of the way to make their service work for you. One of the concerns early on was that because Sheridan didn't have their TSA screening, that would be a little funky for us, that returned to Sheridan in October, and likewise returned at the Riverton Airport. That is all smooth and working well. Denver Air Connection was able to work with the TSA program to now be recognized as a pre-check airline. So if you have that status, you can go through the fast line, which is, I can remember the number, is something like 90+% went through security in under 5 minutes if they were TSA pre-check nationwide. We also developed a new website. If you haven't checked it out, please do, flyriverton.com. It looks great. It's very, it's just up to date. It's modern. It's very welcoming and user-friendly, and that's been getting record number of hits to that as well. Likewise, Denver Air Connection worked on getting us a better gate in Denver, a little closer to the main part of the A Concourse terminal. So lots of good things have been happening, and our flying public is knowing it. They see it, and they're believing it, which is one of our early concerns. Were people going to come back? And they are. So where are we going? Well, one of the things we want to get back to is getting 10,000 enplanements out of this airport. And that seems likely to happen in the near future. If not in the calendar year of 2017, we should be back to hitting that pretty soon. And a big part of how that happens, or why that's important, is that it changes the eligibility for Riverton for the federal airport improvement program funds from 150,000 to 1 million. So 10,000 passengers means we gain 850,000 towards airport projects, which is obviously key for us to be able to have. And certainly a big part of that, not just the flying public coming back, but the Job Corps and the charters that they're doing with Denver Air Connection to be able to get their large volume of students to get back home and back to school during the holidays is a big help for that. So we're hopeful that fairly soon we'll get back to 10,000 from being under 4,000. We're working with Denver Air Connection in developing a frequent flyer program. We think that will likewise make it all the more appealing for people to join. So after a certain number of flights, you would be eligible for a discount coupon of some sort. Details forthcoming. We are becoming more and more precise in our advertising and finding the most effective ways to advertise and what to advertise about. We've worked with Forecast Inc., our revenue management and overall, I'm not sure quite what the right word is, but they help us figure out how to best schedule the flights to maximize our profits for it. So they are now looking at our track record and Sheridan's track record to say, these days we could use an extra plane, and these days it's a low volume, so let's not have a plane fly there, but we will add it in over here. We are obligated because of the state funding to maintain on average 13 flights a week, so they're helping us figure out how do we maximize that so that we can have the best schedule to serve the public and have the best revenue flow. Denver Air Connection is likewise working on filing for the federal 121 status, which is the general commercial license. They're currently flying as a charter. 121 would be helpful for our very long-term goal of being able to be both favorable and then enter into partnership with a legacy air carrier so that we can garner those benefits of baggage being transferred, tickets being purchased all on one and whatnot. And then likewise, we are aware of the need to find additional funding partners for the minimum revenue guarantee. So we are here with a recommendation that we hope that the council will approve the amendment to the Denver Air Connection contract. And part of us doing that now, fairly early in the year, is we are not able to advertise flights and the seats on the flights without a contract in place. And as you're probably aware of, and you probably have friends who want to come visit you for the summer and our tourism economy, right now we can't advertise flights into July and August. So our hope is that as people are starting to make their plans, and folks are, that we can approve the contract and get those flight options up on web pages so that folks can purchase them and then come join us for great activities and hopefully spend a little bit of their money here as well as their time in the Fremont County area. And likewise, our recommendation is to again support $200,000 to support the second year of the minimum revenue guarantee. And we do have a couple of letters of support for this, both from the Lander Chamber of Commerce as well as the Riverton Chamber of Commerce. They've both seen that the importance that reliable air service has for being able to both grow businesses, entice new people to come to our community in general, as well as the importance for that for our tourism industry, which is a big part of Fremont County. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to you for any questions you might have, just knowing that I will try to answer them, but I've also got my team of folks here that, among all of the brains in the room, we'll do our best to answer whatever questions you might have.
Thank you, Missy. Anybody have any questions? Mike?
Your Honor, Missy, is there a time frame on the 121 certification, or is that just whenever the feds get around to it, kind of?
It's a little of both. Our expectation in working with Denver Air is that they are submitting all the paperwork for that right now, and then there's a bit of a we don't know how the other side responds. So their hope is to have everything in place and submitted this calendar year, and then we have no idea what the process will happen after that. It's out of their hands, out of our hands.
Okay. And the numbers that you held up are Riverton's number only?
Yeah. That's correct. This is Riverton only, not including Sheridan.
How is Sheridan doing in comparison to that? Not that it directly affects us, but
Sheridan tends to be on the higher end of that. Yeah, they generally have more of the plane filled. So, but between us, a lot of the morning flights are going out at capacity or very close to, which is awesome.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Other questions?
Doesn't look like it. Does anybody else in the audience have anything they want to say?
I would like to say something.
Come on up.
So my name is Tracy Stratton, and I'm the new interim CEO for Sage West Medical Center. And I just wanted to make a couple of comments about Denver Air Connect and how it directly impacts me personally, as well as company business-wide for us at Sage West. So I'll start off with a personal pieces of information. I use Denver Air Connect every other week because that's when I get to go home. And that service here in the community has provided me safe fast and efficient methods of getting back to my hometown, and I'm not having to spend hours on the road driving back and forth between here and Casper to board a plane to go, and then when I fly back, flying back into Casper and driving again another 2 hours to come back here, when I can fly directly into Riverton and be back at the hospital and on the job in a much more reasonable time frame. So I appreciate having that service here. As was demonstrated in the presentation, the staff there are very friendly. I have found it to be very efficient. I've never been late. And in fact, one of the evenings I was actually on the last flight in, and the other airlines canceled their flight into Riverton, but Denver Air Connect did not. And I was really thankful at that moment in time that I was not on that other airlines, because I would have been spending the night in Denver. But Denver Air Connect came through, and I was able to get here at the time that I needed to, and was ready to be on the ground working Monday morning. So that was very important and very appreciative to me. From a business perspective, it adds a lot of value here to the community. As we have a lot of corporate people that come in and out, it has been proven to be very valuable again to them, just in their travel time and efficiencies of getting in and out of the community, as well as our recruitment of physicians. As I'm talking to physicians and trying to bring on new specialties here, general surgery, OB, etc., orthopedics, one of the things that I'm able to talk to them about is, even though we're a small rural community, you can get in and out of Riverton very easily and get to a major hub airport like Denver and be able to go to wherever you want to go. You don't have to drive 6 hours to Denver or 6 hours to Salt Lake or even the 2 hours to Casper. And that has been a real selling point to the physicians that I've been talking to, and certainly a bonus for the Riverton community. And I think that'll continue to add value as we continue to recruit and do business here in Riverton. So I just wanted to share my thoughts with you guys tonight. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you. Julie?
So, good evening. My name is Julie Gassner. I'm the Center Director at Wind River Job Corps Center. And I, too, would like to share a personal as well as a business-related experience with use of both Denver Air Connections as well as Great Lakes since the change in July. So, personally, I've been in the community since May of 2015, and my family is still outside of this community. And so, once a month, one of us is traveling to Oregon and the other one is traveling here. So, twice, we'd have two flights a month. And pre-Denver Air Connect, we were traveling to Casper, that 2 hours, and as you heard earlier, that time on the road, time away from business, etc. So since Great Lakes and Denver Air Connect are now more readily available, we both have the luxury of being able to utilize the aircraft, and I was just on the flight last night coming back. Dependability, reliability saves me time. I can go home for a weekend Friday, be back for work on Monday. So greatly appreciate that, both personally. The connections have been able to, you know, just that planning ahead, because I go on from Denver to Oregon with another connection flight, and it's been seamless. I've checked bags, I've not checked bags, and it's worked out great. We've had flights canceled on the other side, not as a result of air travel here, but due to weather, and great. Denver Air Connections was kind enough to rebook us at no expense, so we greatly appreciate that service. On the business side, so Wind River Job Corps Center opened our doors August 4th, 2015. On average, 7 students arrive every week, and now we're at the point, we've celebrated 3 graduations. Students are leaving every week, completing the program. So with that, we are flying students here that are from outside of Wyoming, so Utah, Montana, and Colorado. Right now, about 40% of our 200 population is Wyoming. So the balance, we're having to fly in. Since July, we have used 283 segments, transporting students on Denver Air Connections to the Riverton area, as well as sending them home to once they completed the program. We've utilized Great Lakes on 5 occasions, and we utilize Great Lakes, and they have been dependable and they have been reliable since this change in July for our minor students. And the reason why we do that with our minor students is because they don't have to deal with the baggage change in Denver, and we don't want the minors to get lost. And our minors are our 16 and 17 year olds. So the majority of our students, average age is 19, we're utilizing Denver Air Connections. They have been nothing but kind and generous with our students. They have been easy for them to navigate the airport. Our kids coming in out of Montana, Utah, in Colorado, other parts, not the big city. That's scary. It's overwhelming. First-time flyers, I don't know where I'm going. It's a big airport. The agents have been kind, generous, and helped our students navigate. We haven't had any issues with luggage. We haven't had any issues with delayed flights. And again, the only time that we've had to utilize Great Lakes, and it's not that we don't choose to, is with our youth or if there's a cancellation or a delay. But again, Denver has been fantastic for us. We will continue to utilize them. Over the winter break, I had shared with Denver Air Connections. They came to the center. We were able to negotiate a very competitive cost savings measure to transport all of our students that went home for the winter break, which was roughly 130 students that left Riverton to go to Wyoming, Utah, or Utah, Montana, or Colorado. And they had two flights that went to Denver and a flight that went to Salt Lake, went off without a hitch. The staff up there were great. Our students were great. We got praise from the staff, how well the students were behaved. But we appreciate that cost savings because the previous winter, we had to rent two charters. One charter went to a bus, went to Jackson to fly students going towards Montana. So we had the expense of the charter plus the expense of those flights out of Jackson. And then we had another charter that went to Casper. So that expense plus the expense of those flights to get the students beyond that. So it was a significant savings for us, and we greatly appreciate that. So we thank you, we support them very much, and we look forward to continued transport, both personal and private.
Thank you, Julie. So we have a contract.
Your Honor, that is correct. We do.
So this is basically the contract that we signed last year, except we have a little addendum to it, right?
Your Honor, that is correct. Rather than revamping the entire contract, an addendum was made with essentially four changes as outlined in the staff report. These changes updated the dates, obviously, and then the MRG total, which last year for this current contract, is $3,976,965. That's shared between Sheridan and and this year it's $3,729,465.
So it went down a little bit.
Went down a little bit. And so the amendment really updates that information.
Thank you. So the chair would entertain a motion.
Your Honor, I would move that the Riverton City Council approve the amended Denver Air Connections contract.
Second.
And allocate $200,000 in the next fiscal year budget to offices or to fund the minimum revenue guarantee.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion.
Right, Your Honor, I only have one question for Kyle. So where we split the revenue guarantee with Sheridan 50-50 basically, where they have more, they sell more seats than we do, does that offset some of that, or how does that work exactly?
Your Honor, Councilman Bailey, it is a true 50-50 split. And so quite frankly, we benefit from the performance of Sheridan. A monthly average for the second quarter of service, we had a 62.78% load factor. Riverton's portion of that was 16.72%. So we are still building our market and we are benefiting from Sheridan and that 50-50 cost split.
So hypothetically, the over 15 seats they sell goes toward helping us offset our minimum revenue guarantee.
Your Honor, that is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Tim?
The change from 13 round-trip flights per week to a minimum of 13 flights per week, is that just like at the end of the year that they would determine that, or how does that work? I just was confused about what that means exactly there.
Your Honor, Councilman Hancock, what that provision talks about is in the original contract, it stated that there would be a minimum of 13 flights per week. round-trip flights. The new contract states that there will be an average of 13 flights. The reason why that's in there is for CAST, which is the task force for Sheridan, and FAST, our task force, to look at opportunities to generate more revenue around weekend travel, holiday travel. And so it's an opportunity to amend the schedule, which has to be approved by the Department of Transportation to basically increase revenues.
But it's still in terms of, as she was mentioning, the state funding required an average of 13 flights per week. That still is going to be required pursuant to the new amendments to the contract.
Your Honor, that is correct. And we have worked with Aeronautics. We have a proposed schedule for year two. Which does address some of the holiday travel dates and then seasonal travel dates. For example, for summer travel, we find that Tuesdays are low travel days, but the weekends are high travel days, so we'd like to shift some flights to cover that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mayor votes aye, and the motion passes. Thank you. Thanks, FAST, for coming and talking to us, and for the work that you've done on getting this new contract ready. There's been a lot of telephone calls and emails back and forth for the last 2 months to pull this together. So, thank you very much.
It's certainly easier getting it started.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, once you get it moving, it's easier.
You got momentum now.
Yeah, it's got momentum now. Okay. So the chair would entertain a motion to convene into a work session.
Your Honor, I make a motion that we convene into a work session.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Mayor votes aye. So we are now in a work session. The first thing on the agenda tonight is my Riverton Mobile application presentation. Finance Division Manager's report, please.
Well, good evening, Mayor, Council. I am here to share some information with you with regards to a new mobile application that will be available to the citizens of Riverton to access more information with the city online. We partnered with a program called Smart Utilities in March of 2016 to create a web and mobile application for citizens to access their city accounts 24/7. Customers will have the ability to receive notifications, pay bills, check their water usage, view outages, schedule service requests, and much more with this technology. The mobile app increases customer satisfaction by giving your customers convenience and control to access their data anytime, anywhere, on any device. So I'm just excited to just introduce the web portal of this today. This mobile application is also compatible with iOS and Android cell phone devices, as well as laptops, tablets, and then we have the web portal. So I'm just gonna give you just a briefing of what's going to be available out there and just take you on a little tour of the mobile site. So the first thing I'm going to do is just log on, and I have already established a utility account for my personal residence, so you're going to get to see all that goodness. Okay, so this is their landing page when you first log on. You'll be required to register, obviously, and it will just inquire on some personal information as far as establishing an account for you. It's just going to ask your basic utility account number, your residence address. You'll establish a username and password for yourself. And then on the landing page, the first thing that we have is the billing screen, which it will give you the balance due on your utility bill and the date that it's due. You have the option to actually view your bill, and it will give you a PDF document, which is printable for people who like to have paper records, which also includes all your usage and the same data as far as your prior reading on your account, your current reading, your usage, and then a breakdown of your billing between your garbage, sewer, and water, and then any other city services that folks are billed on. If we actually click the pay bill link, this will actually redirect you right to our third-party vendor, National Payment Solutions. And for folks that are currently paying their bills online, this service does not change at all. So you'll just use your standard login information and pay your bill online right through that portal. It's important for me to mention that with this mobile app, it does not replace any of our current City of Riverton billing programs that we use, our software. All this does is just lay a net over all of our current things that we're utilizing as far as customer access goes. So for those people who rely on our website, that's still going to be available. For online payment processing, that's still going to be available. You'll still be able to sign up for paperless billing, have all the same services that we've always had in the past. This second window here is water usage. I particularly like this. It gives you a breakdown of what actual your water usage is, not only by dollar amount, but also by thousands of gallons that are used. And it's a month-by-month-by-month breakdown. And so what you're viewing here is what my water service cost me over the months of October, November, December, and January. And then if I click here, let's see. Sorry, I'm relatively new at this. If I click water rates for customers who have questions or concerns with regards to what our rates are, you can click rates and it links you right over to our city website with all the current rates as well. And then also, there we go. This gives a listing of how many gallons that I used per month, so you can actually monitor and track your trending. The other thing is that it will also give you seasonal usage. So for our residential customers, we base your sewer bill on your water usage during the months of December, January, and February. So you can actually see what my usage consumed was during those months, and then that will help you to determine what your sewer average is going to be each month for the off months. And back to the main screen. This is a particular favorite of mine. It's outages. So with this new mobile app, we will have the ability to pinpoint any outages of water that are going on within the city system, and customers will have the ability to sign up to receive notifications from us. So if there's a water outage, we can literally go through and identify the particular neighborhood where we're experiencing an outage, the date that the outage occurred, the estimated restoration time, the number of customers that are affected by the outage. So it's kind of fun. I've been working in the test bank with this, and the folks at the Spark customer mobile app were working on this the other night, and I was getting ping notifications on my cell phone in the middle of the night that there were outages for water at the City of Riverton. So whenever they're occurring and we're getting them out on the system, that notification is going out to customers right away. So that's something new and exciting. This little tab here, notifications. So customers have the ability to sign up to receive specific notifications. One of them, of course, is an outage. You can get notifications if you contact the city for any reason, say you're requesting a service change. We will send you a notification once we receive that, and it will show up in your email notification box. So this is just a test environment, and it's just notifying me of anything that I have signed up for. Any changes that have been made, it comes back to me through this portal here. And then two more things. This is just my account tab, and it's just basic information as far as my home. Bounced around on me a little bit. Okay, so this is just some of my personal information. It talks a little bit about my home. And I can set information, one more screen here, as far as what my home is like, the number of people that I have living there, the square footage in my home, do I have a pool, how big is my landscaping area, just different things like that that will help our utility billing clerks answer questions for folks as far as why is my water bill so large, is this something that I should anticipate for the size of my property, just different information like that. And then this settings tab is where our customers can go up to sign or go to sign up to receive information from us. You can determine whether you want it set by email or your notifications to be sent by push notification so that they're received on your cell phone. Next tab is usage, which I believe we went over. Let's see if there's anything else on there that I missed for you. Did not. Billing. Okay, so as far as billing goes, it also will provide access to your billing history. So this is a growing database. So we just started working on this in October as far as boarding customer information. So this will stay out on your account for an extended period of time. Right now, there's 4 months worth of utility bills that I could go back and refer to. I can view them in PDF format. Billing queries, if I've got a question about my bill, I can actually just type up a topic, not only about my bill, rebates, conservation, if I want to report an outage, if I want to report water theft, a water leak, or if I want to report a stop sign being down. I can go out to the Contact Us tab here on this particular page and then notify the City of Riverton of any issues that I may have found out in the field. One thing, I'll go back to the notifications tab. I did do a report today, and I'll show you what that looks like from the other side. If you want to link to our Facebook page, it's linked to the Facebook page, and then also it's linked to YouTube, so our citizens can go out and have quick access to City Council meetings right here through this web portal as well. Okay, as far as service goes, if I want to, for customers that are moving in and out of Riverton, I can schedule service change requests, whether it's moving out of a property, moving in, or moving from one location to another. It's all done online through here. And then we also have a conservation tab. Now remember, we are in the test environment on this, but these offer information regarding any types of rebates that would be available to customers. I have also wanted to add information with regards to our curbside recycling program. So here that says just save money by recycling, and if you can click to read more about it, encourages people to sign up for recycling. Any cost-saving tips that we have as far as water usage, energy savings, different things like that. And then educational tips, which is kind of along the same lines of cost-saving tips. Recycling, reimagining your yard, adjusting your sprinkler heads to save some money. So I wanted to just step back one time on the notifications tab. So today I responded to an outage. And so I sent an email to the City of Riverton through this web portal to let us know. And this is the response, an automated response that I got back. And it just basically says, thanks for contacting us. We will respond to your request within 2 business days. But I just wanted to put a quick attachment on here just to show you how it works. So I did report the outage, but I also sent in a picture. So I took a picture of just outside of City Hall and linked it right up to the site. So if you see a stop sign being down, a broken water main somewhere, different things like that, citizens can actually snap photos of exactly where this location is, and then it just helps for our city staff to dispatch the crews out and get the issues corrected. And then the other thing that this also does is it saves any reporting that you do in a PDF format so that we as citizens have records of what we've reported, and then also this same attachment comes across on the city side. A lot of this site is self-administered, so our city staff here will have the ability to help customers with changing passwords if they need to do that, changing password questions. We can make any changes to our rebate programs. Obviously, we can report the water outages, so there's a lot of self-administration that goes into this program as well. So we anticipate that we should be rolling out in approximately a month. We are working with Smart Customer Mobile to have a marketing strategy in order to help get the word out to our citizens. So it's something that's been a long time coming. We're real excited about the convenience of the product. Any questions?
Thank you. Any questions, Council?
Martin, Maya, what's the landing? What's the name of the application?
It's called My Riverton Mobile App. is what it'll be. And you'll get it through your app store, so just like you do with most of your, with your cell phone apps, it is purchased through the app store. It's free, so, but it is, you can get it through the app store. It's not available yet.
Kyle's ready to sign up right now.
He's signing up.
Okay, Mike?
Mia, on this, does it have the ability to let more than one person look at the same account? So can you have more than one user on an account? So for example, landlord rental kind of a scenario, or?
You cannot, and we did discuss a landlord rental situation, but if, what happens in our current environment now is that if we have a person that owns a piece of property and they want their renter to put the services in their name, they're required to establish a separate utility account. We do notify the landlord through the billing process if the renter becomes late on the property or on the bill, but you're not going to be able to go out and view your renter's activity through this portal. They are proprietary to the owner of the account.
Account only.
Right.
So me and my wife, Pat, can't look at your bill because you already are looking at it.
Yeah. Okay. I would have to let him know what our username and password is. Yeah, but it is specific to an account.
Way to put him on the spot, Mike.
He lets me pay that bill anyway, so yes. Good.
Sean?
So I guess the question I have is there a way we're going to be able to track who uses this system?
Yes, we can track who uses the system. There actually is, let's see, I can log on real quick to the city side of it so you can see.
So while you're doing that, my second part of that question is, would this be a way that we could eliminate having to send out those, what was the number she used for the second and third and final notice slips that we send out to try to eliminate some of that?
We can. I think when we do that, what we need to change is a pattern of behavior with citizens as far as paying their bills. A lot of people wait until they get there. Shut off notice before
right.
they pay their bill. They wait until they get their phone call before they pay their bill. Yes, this is definitely a notification that's going to help, because if they sign up for push notifications right now, in our current environment, we don't offer that. So that push notification is going to send a banner right out to their cell phone that says, hey, you need to get in and pay your water bill. So potentially, yes, potentially that is something that we could look at, depending upon our trends, how many people were getting signed up, and different things like that.
Okay.
Is there any policy or ordinance in place in terms of that and it, with water shut off? I mean, what is the status right now? Is it, do we have a, what's the policy? Is it based on ordinance?
Yes, it is.
So, I mean, I guess I could conceive that there would be a way that you could write that into the ordinance that somebody who signs up for this maybe would be still getting the notifications per the ordinance. I think there could be a way to do that, to make it so that this would be how they would be getting their notifications, and that they could.
Qualify as a notification.
Yes.
A replacement to our paper shutoff
right.
notices as well.
And so I'm just saying that could be an idea as a way to do that down the road.
Because it would save us a lot of money if having not to send out those
mm-hmm.
every month, 2 months, 3 months sometimes per household until they finally get okay. The water didn't come on, I better go pay my bill.
I mean, even if it were just in terms of a waiver when they do it, to say this is, I am agreeing that I will be receiving notifications in terms of shut off any other things through this application rather than paper or whatever. I mean, we do it all the time with banking where you go paperless or something where they.
When you go paperless, absolutely. Yep.
Thanks, Mia.
You bet. Somebody was asking about the trends, to how we can see how many customers have logged in and signed up. So this just gives us a little analysis page as far as registered customers and active users. And this goes into a lot of depth. It will even tell us how many are registered Android users, how many are registered iOS users, who use the web portal. I mean, it can dial down to number of clicks. I mean, so there's all kinds of analytical information that you can get from this dashboard as well. Okay. The CSR workbench, this is just information as far as what our utility billing and finance clerks will utilize on a daily basis to help assist people with their registrations. And then also on the back side of things, when folks are asking for service transfer requests, different things like that, it's all coming up through here. So that's how they'll track it. Are there requests, questions?
So did we already have this built into the budget for this year?
We did. Yeah, there was an initiation fee that was charged and a one-time implementation fee, and that was actually already paid last year in last year's budget. We did sign up for a three-year contract. It runs $6,375 per year, and that is allocated out between four different funds, the general fund, and then and divided up equally between the enterprise.
Sewer, water, utilities, whatever.
Tim?
Are we going to be looking at any savings that we can get through this? Is there a way we could use it to get savings? I mean, like we were talking about sending out notifications. Are there any other ways that we can use this to save the city money?
Actually, when they introduced this program to us, they have reported that other utility companies that are using this program have cut down their call volume 30% inside of their offices. So I think you're going to have some time savings with our employees, for one thing. The other thing, obviously, is that we continue to encourage folks to use online vehicles for any of their bill processing. So I think that we're going to see an increased savings as far as with our postage and our paperless billing, because people have access to so much more information from their fingertips than they did before. With our old paperless bill, that's exactly all they would get, was just a bill. This has so much more analytical information behind it that I think that more people are going to use it.
And I mean, in terms of somebody being able to monitor their water usage and everything, rather than keeping the little pink slip and comparing that month to month, being able to see it on a graph is definitely useful. And you could, I don't know, enforce yourself in terms of lowering your water usage or mm-hmm. whatever if you're trying to lower your bill. So
absolutely. Yep, absolutely.
I did have one more.
Go ahead, Sean.
You might have said this, but I don't remember. Right now it's tracking 4 months. When it's up and running, will it have a history of all the way back from October when it initiated?
I think what it's going to continue to track is it'll track up to a 12-month period so that you can compare 1 year's month. So say it'll track clear up through February of next year, so you'll be able to see your entire year's worth of data, and then it should start to roll from that
okay.
point.
Good. Thanks, Mia.
Thank you all for your time.
That looks fun.
It's exciting.
Okay. The next item on our agenda this evening is temporary merchant ordinance discussion. Community Development Director's report, please.
Yes, Your Honor. This is something that we've looked at for many, many years, is trying to get some kind of an ordinance or on the books regarding temporary merchants. And mostly it's the transient merchants that we really wanted to try to have some kind of an ordinance for. We've met several times with a lot of different people, senior staff and Planning Commission a couple times, and our community development, and we've gone over a lot of things. And I mean, we've done this, been working on this for several years. At this point in time, I think we have done a fairly good job of putting this together. There are a few things that we're just not sure that we have exactly right, and one of them is fees. I think when the Planning Commission came up with some, they were thinking, more of out-of-town fees and things for people that were coming into town. And I'll go over a little bit of that in a minute. But we have a couple of entities in town that are local people and that have been doing some things for quite a while, the same. And I think the fees are a little high on that, and we need to probably look at some, and I don't know how to do it differently, because we've got to be careful we're not discriminating, against different businesses, whether they're local or whether they're out of state. But I think we need to definitely work on the fees. But I was going to go through just a little bit of what we've done. Before, what we were doing a variance type of a thing, which a variance is not really the correct way to do this, but we didn't know how to control things except for doing that at the time while we were working on this ordinance. So we've come up with a few things that we are requiring, and one of the things is the temporary merchant that we permit must be conducted on commercial property with the permission of the established business owner. No overnight lodging will be allowed. There's quite a few things that give some definitions. In this case, temporary is considered 6 months or less, is what our definition is on this. The provisions do not apply to the sale of garden products or farm products that are produced by the same person that's trying to sell them, and that takes care of our farmers markets and those types of things. And you can see that there's several other things, newspapers, the occasional sale by local school students, and like Elks, Kiwanis, Lions, Boy and Girl Scouts, those are not considered in here. Garage sales are not considered in here as long as they don't exceed more than two separate sales in a calendar year, not to exceed 3 days each. And that's so somebody doesn't have a perpetual garage sale without some kind of permitting. And then any organization that is exempt from taxation, like a 501c3. The other thing we will end up doing is we will verify that there's compliance with the Wyoming Department of Revenue so that we know that they are charging and paying sales tax. We have someone in town now that is from the Department of Revenue that will help with that also. Let's see, and then we put some hours, some business hours in there, and we said that they have to, that the temporary merchant has to keep track. We won't send out renewal times because sometimes temporary merchants might only be for a weekend or, you know, for a week or two. Let's see. Okay. I was going to say, under the general information, we've had a hard time trying to decide just how to do this. We looked up a lot of different municipalities, and it's done lots of different ways. The one that we took most everything from, I think, was Dubois, and they charged a fee for the number of days at $125 per day, or an annual fee of $450, or a group license is so many people times so many days times $10, and it all seemed kind of confusing. So I think where we ended up was with the $400 that we have up to 6 months, which I think is a little high, is probably from that one. We had another one. They have some temporary merchants from up to 45 days for $95, and then over 45 days, $310. So that's what I mean. It varies a lot. There's some of them that start out at $25 and then go up depending on the number of days. Some just have a flat fee for no matter how many days you are. But I've got it from $100 to, you know, for those up to $300, just no matter what they do. Another one, $10, $25, and $100. So that's where I could stand a little bit of guidance on those fees. And if you see some other things, we've gone over this permitting for temporary merchants quite a bit. And a lot of the other items, I believe, are covered pretty well. But we really need to try to figure out what we really want or what the council really wants as far as regulating temporary merchants in town. Any other questions?
Thank you, Cindy. Kyle?
The shaved ice or the hot dog stand, is that, I don't know if they're longer than.
Okay, the hot dog stand is on its own. It's a separate, it's a total separate entity than what the shaved ice is. But the shaved ice is one of the ones that I'm talking about, because they're there every year. It is temporary, but it's not really like a temporary merchant, like a transient merchant that we normally, that we're really trying to regulate in this situation. And so that's one of the ones we have to kind of decide if we want to do something different with, if we want to call it a pre-existing non-conforming use, since they're there every summer all the time. So there's different ways of dealing with those.
Well, what I'm trying to, Sandy, what I'm trying to figure out is if we're Are we talking about the Kirby salesman, or are we talking about, we don't have this around here where we have, if you go down to Ogden, Utah, down there at the city administration building, there must be 15 to 20 taco rolling carts. Is that what we're saying is a temporary?
Your Honor, it's more the people that come in, and one of them is like blanket sales. Now, if somebody wanted to come in and sell some blankets, then they would have to go to a merchant that would allow them to sell on their property. And so it's more, some more commodities or food. It can still be food sales. Somebody wants to set up to sell food for a week or two, or tools for a week or two, those types of things.
Okay.
Tim?
Just a couple of things. I mean, as it is, we don't have any regulation of garage sales or anything. This is an exception here. But I could see where that could be read to say that if you have a garage sale exceeding two separate sales in one calendar year, you would have to get one of these permits. I guess my thought would be, in terms of exceptions, probably would make more sense just to say any garage sales are accepted, unless we're really wanting to get in the business of regulating garage sales, which I don't think as a city council we are. I don't know. I'm not.
That's really probably the case. We have had a couple of places in town, I suppose the reason we put this in, that have a perpetual garage sale in their residential area, and we've gotten complaints, and I don't know where they get their things, but they're actually doing a business out of their residential house in that situation.
Then isn't that turning into a zoning issue as opposed to doing a temporary?
It could be treated for the zoning. It could be treated that same way. I mean, it could be treated like you're doing a business, a home occupation business, and they were not complying. So we could treat it differently. Yes, we could just say no garage sales at this time. That was verbiage from another municipality.
And I was looking at, in terms of, it looks like we're saying that this would be applying to commercial businesses only. When you look at how we're defining. How we'd be defining this. Am I correct there, or are we saying that this would apply to residential properties as well?
Commercial.
Okay, so I mean, as it is, that would... Okay, so we're talking commercial only then. This is would not have an impact on residential areas.
That's correct.
It's not allowed in those areas at all.
Correct.
Yeah, as it is. Right. But that's where I'm saying this language about garage sales didn't make sense to me. If we were wanting to be doing something about that, I don't think this is the place to do it.
Well, the garage sales, what we're looking at is the Fred Sanford and Son scenario. That's before your time, but somebody has a clutter in their front yard, and they're selling the lawnmowers all the time, or they're selling something else. And so that doesn't become a sales issue. That's a zoning issue. And we had one like that this last fall or before that, I think, where individuals were buying, going to other garage sales, buying stuff, putting it on display in their own area.
There is another reason to stipulate this a little bit, because it does say garage, yard sale, or similar sales by individuals at the residence or place of business. So that does limit somebody having a garage sale out in front of their store more than a couple times a year, which there are some businesses that do that, which a couple times a year, it's not a problem. And then they usually do it for a fundraiser for a group is usually what it's done. So maybe we just limit it to the commercial end of it, and we've had some of those. Again, same thing.
Mr. Peterson.
Sandy, I was reading through this, and I kind of come up with the same thing that Tim did. Does this cover, like, our day in the park?
Yes, it does. It says...
I read through it, but it was a lot of reading, so...
Let's see. There's a place in here that talks about events. one of these says, I know it has events that.
Number seven.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, the reason I asked is because that's one of the questions that's been brought up in our Eclipse meetings, is we have people that are coming in who want to occupy the side of the street because of all these people are hitting town. You know, that's one of the questions that we've had, discussions that we've had, is what are we going to do for the, you know, the people that are trying to sell their rock jewelry on the side of the road? Are we going to? That's the reason I asked that question.
Your Honor, at this point in time, no sales are allowed on public property in the town as it is. So the only place that a sale could take place would be within a business parking lot, if it's allowed by the business and they meet the other qualifications in that situation. So they can't do that already. Now, city park, special event, then that's where we do the exception. City park, we don't monitor that. But I do know that the Department of Revenue lady does check those people out, I found out.
So for each one of those booths down there at the day in the park, they have to pay for the 100 for the, or whatever the
fee? No.
So no. They're all covered underneath that one special event?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct, yes. We're not trying to stifle any of that. It's mostly for the temporary merchants that come into town. And we've, you know, there's not a lot, but there have been some issues with some of that. There's been some parking issues. There's been some people complaining because other cars are on their lot. I mean, those types of things. So those are one of the things that we really want to control as much as anything. And we've had complaints from people across the street that have an established business selling the same thing, you know. Now that's free trade, but they need to have, you know, some kind of a permit and make sure that they're paying the same taxes and those types of things. So that's another thing that we make sure, and insurance. They have to have insurance.
Thank you, Sandy.
Mm-hmm.
You're on.
Mike?
Sandy, so if this, we put this into effect, would that eliminate the variances that we're doing now?
Correct, and that's what we want to do, is to eliminate those variances, so we're not doing that variance thing.
We don't want to have to double whammy. We don't have to get a variance and have a permit.
That's exactly right. That's what we're trying to do.
To me, the only real concern I see in the whole thing is just, we want to make sure that the existing businesses that we've been doing variances for forever, and there's four or five in Riverton that are what I would almost consider permanent businesses, that we're not punishing them, for lack of a better term of calling it.
And that's correct, and we don't want to do that. So we would take the variances away and the fees that they're paying for the variance, then the individual vendors are the ones that would have to pay.
So to me, I'm wondering if we shouldn't maybe make this 6-month definition of temporary, maybe 3, so that the permanent variance folks would always exceed that, and then we could come up with a separate way that we treat them.
That so might be an answer.
I think, again, the shaved ice thing
that
is probably for
answer.
4 months, 3 months or more would cover what they do. It would cover the hot dog stand. It would cover, you know, some of these kind of guys that are here all summer. But yet, the in-town for the weekend guy would still get covered. And I guess to me, my primary concern is that we're covering, you know, insurance, sales tax, and health code for food vendors, so that at least we are all playing on a level playing field. I think that's the biggest complaint we get from merchants, is that some fly-by-night guy comes in, he's selling stuff, he's not charging sales tax, he doesn't have liability insurance, he doesn't pay property tax, he's just coming in, making his money, and leaving town before anybody knows he's there, kind of a scenario.
That's correct. Now, that's a good idea, and that's one of the, I think that might be the way to solve some of these. I think, you know, if that's kind of a direction, we'll take that back and work on that just a little more on that direction. That might, if that sounds, most of the rest of the things we've gone through, and they all seem to have passed muster on all the rest of the groups on what we're trying to do, but that was one that we need to definitely work on, and I knew that we needed to do that, so.
Okay, Stephen?
Your Honor, there was a question about temporary. What is the definition of temporary? And we struggle with that a little bit. But one thing we came to the conclusion on is, if it's hooked up to utilities, like water, sewer, or electricity, then that's treated like a permanent business compared to, because we started thinking, well, you got these coffee shops all over the place. Is that a temporary merchant if they're only open certain times? And so if they're hooked up to power, which some of those are, I mean, maybe even that ice shop, I don't know, they probably have power and stuff to that. And so it is more permanent in nature because it actually has services provided to it compared to something that really is temporary in nature that's meant that could move tomorrow without any issues.
Anybody else have anything they'd like to say? Go ahead. Come on up.
A couple questions. you're talking about this. I'm getting the feeling this is more about revenue than it is about control. And I will tell you.
Could you state your name, please?
My name is Visor.
Okay.
And I've had a variance for years across the street, as you know. I don't mind getting rid of the variance. I know Howard has always had an issue with it. He didn't feel that was the appropriate vehicle to do this. I will tell you the advantage of having a variance, as I can begin to tell you how many people approached me to sell on my lot, but as long as I'm right across the street from City Hall and pretending to be a legitimate businessman, I adhere to the terminology within my variance. Nobody sat up on there without insurance. They had to have a state tax ID number. And most of the people that wanted to sell could not provide that. I'll also tell you that you're essentially going to eliminate it. Say it's almost like the intent of this is just to completely eliminate transient vendors, because they're not going to spend that kind of money. They balk at $50 a day to park in my lot. If they got to pay me and then pay the city sounds like it's almost like the city's trying to help themselves to the profit without taking any risk. If you make the fees prohibitive, you will prohibit it. Most of these transient merchants aren't going to spend that. And if the idea is to keep out of town people from selling in town, this will definitely do the job. But now we're kind of being restrained of trade.
Your Honor. We that was not our idea, but we do spend some time doing some of the paperwork that we're already doing right now, okay? And we check with some of the sales tax things and some of those other things now, and like you said, the variance was not the best way to do it. I just kind of got through saying that I'm pretty sure that our fees are not what they need to be, and I will agree with that, but we need to, obviously cover our costs to have these vendors do there.
Absolutely.
I mean, so that's, and so the costs I know are an issue, and that's why I said we did that just because we started with one of the other, municipalities, which happened to be Du Bois at that time, and we went from there. And this is a work session, so this is just a draft, and that's why we're just, working on it.
And I think the season pass, I know I have a, produce guy comes in every year. I know there's produce people that are down there at the co-op. It would probably be beneficial if you could just do a season,
get
a season pass, so a reasonable fee, so that he doesn't know how many times he's going to be here. He goes all around the state. If he's making a killing in Casper, he doesn't come to Riverton that week. But if it's dead in Casper and dead in Rock Springs, then he might be here 3 weeks in a row. It would be definitely beneficial if they could buy a reasonably priced season pass and know they can set up here for the duration of the season.
Your Honor,
go ahead.
I think we need to have just a little more control of that, though. I really do. I mean, because
as far as
that's pretty much open-ended. And
well, you have a season pass. You have a limit. 3 months, whatever.
Okay.
But so,
and then I'm agreed to that.
Yeah.
Then I'm agreed to that.
I don't mean the year-round season pass. He's not going to be up here selling peaches in February. Wish he would.
But see, in that case, then he would have a temporary merchant permit for a specific set of time, and then he could.
Yeah, anyway. You can make it reasonable, and
yeah.
And then fine with me if I don't have to mess around with getting a variance every year.
That's what we thought.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mike?
And again, I think the main objective here is to make sure we have these people paying sales tax, having insurance, doing our duty to sort of protect the public from, you know, food vendors that aren't following any health codes, and, you know, have some, that way you've been notified they're there, you know, we've got a record of it. You can call the health, you know, if you get a complaint, you can call the health inspection lady and do what would be prudent to make sure we're protecting the public and the other businesses in the area, that we're, you know, we're all playing on a level playing field.
So. Yes, sure.
I would like to add, Sandy, the one advantage of the variance is I would guide the police that without variance, that's all on your hair.
And I will totally agree with that, but I might have someone that's not quite like you with the policing, and so this way then at least we're covering for some of that. And I have to admit, Visor has done a very good job.
Tim?
What has been the deal? I mean, you mentioned blanket sales. I know they'll do that every once in a while in the Safeway parking lot. I know the sticker bus occasionally over near the River City Bar. I mean, is there anything where that has been regulated thus far? Are they just kind of coming in and leaving before, I mean, kind of like Mr. Bailey was saying, before anybody wises up that something's going on here that maybe they should be?
Your Honor, that does happen on occasions, and that's another reason for trying to get this in place. Then we have something specifically in place that we can regulate from. At this point in time, that happens on occasions. As long as businesses are aware that that vendor has to have a license in order to be in his parking lot, then that would help quite a bit. And the other thing, the thing that we do, because if you have a temporary merchant, you need to make sure that they have a place, that they have some sanitary facilities available. And that's another reason for allowing them just in business, on business property that's already established, because then you know that they do have permission to utilize the facilities.
So you're suggesting then that this would capture those situations, and those folks would have to come and get whatever it would be in terms of a temporary license to do this?
That is correct.
And but also would make it easier to enforce and give them the option of how to go and do this.
Correct.
Rather than just leaving them out to dry with everything that they've set up, saying, no, this is the process to go through.
That is correct, because we have not had that ability to do that up to now.
Did you get what you needed?
I believe so. We'll go back to the drawing board a little bit, and we'll talk with some of these folk and see if we can't come up with something just a little bit better.
Okay, all right.
Thank you very much.
All right.
I guess
one more.
I agree. It seems like the idea here isn't to make revenue for the city. I would think that whatever we decide as a fee would need to be just as low as we can make it, so that we're not discouraging too much, but still being able to cover our costs.
Cover our costs and control the situations, yes.
Okay. The chair would entertain a motion to reconvene into a special meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Your vote's aye. We're back into our regular special meeting. I do have a little piece of business here that we need to take care of with regards to our interim search. I think what we're gonna, just looking at the calendar, next Monday is a holiday. Okay, so we're gonna take applications through Thursday. Okay, then I'll have Megan make a copy of that, all the applications that we get, and they'll be in your mailboxes at City Hall. So on Friday, you can pick them up, and you'll have those applications to look at over the weekend. And then Tuesday, at our regular meeting, we'll have an exec session so that we can come in and talk about the applications, see what process we want to follow, how we want to do that. Maybe on Wednesday or Thursday, we can schedule some Skype interviews, and then after that, have a exec session to make a selection.
So rather than kind of what we'd been discussing of having the special session on Monday because we've got a holiday that day.
Right.
Then we have the regular meeting on Tuesday and have a special session after the regular meeting to figure out where we're going to go.
Right. Give us just a little bit more time to move those look at those applications and see what we want to do. And I think we'll have a little more breathing room on that.
So you're thinking Wednesday, possibly,
Wednesday,
or Thursday?
Wednesday or Thursday, we could do a special session too. But we'll have to figure that out, kind of based on if we're going to interview people, use Skype or something like that for some distance interviewing, and our local people as well. We do have to have a day or two that we can talk to them to get them to come in, make an appointment so that they can get here. So we'll kind of have to be a little flexible on that.
I guess to me, we need to be able to set a day so we can give them as much notice as possible after we've had. So you're thinking, I guess, on the 21st, we might whittle that down to the top couple of three, assuming
yes.
we get a bunch?
Yes.
Okay, so then we'd be able to notify them, give them 2 days planning to that we're going to have an interview on Thursday.
And we could make the selection on Thursday following the interview.
We could. After we're done interviewing, then we could.
So we'll have to make it also.
If Thursday's bad for one of us, should we say something now?
Yes.
It's senior night for the high school, for the fall sports, so I will be there with my daughter.
Okay.
What time is that?
It's at the 7 o'clock varsity basketball game against Lander.
Do they have a problem doing it earlier?
Afternoon?
I mean, do it 4 o'clock? Or?
I'm off at 1 o'clock. I'm available after that. So I know not everybody is, but
I'm off at 5.
5? I'd be able to come whenever, since I'm gimping anyway.
I could do 5.
You could do 5?
We could also do Wednesday, but I do like the idea of 2 days rather than just one day.
A little bit of notice so they have time to plan.
Mm-hmm. So is Thursday at 5 okay?
This coming Thursday.
Next Thursday.
Next Thursday.
The 23rd.
Be the 23rd.
Okay.
Okay. So on the 23rd at 5 o'clock, okay? So we'll try to get people lined up for interviews then. But after Tuesday night, we'll know who we want to interview. Okay? All right. All right. I'd entertain him.
So, I'll talk to you.
I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
We moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We are adjourned at 8:18.